notice of the lack of a notice of appearance.
So do you think that you need to distinguish Pierre Paul or not?
Well, I think Pierre Paul is distinguished in that, from all appearances in that case, that the issue, precise issue raised by the petitioner was that the immigration judge lacked subject matter jurisdiction and not personal jurisdiction. And as the court emphasized in that opinion, the petitioner did not raise any objection to the sufficiency of the notice to appear before the IJ or before the board. So if it had been a personal jurisdiction argument, if the petitioner had tried to challenge personal jurisdiction, the petitioner would have waived that argument. But that's not true here.
Are you arguing about the sua sponte reopening still?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, why do we have jurisdiction over that? How do we have jurisdiction over that?
Because generally the courts lack jurisdiction over a challenge to refusal to reopen sua sponte proceedings because there is no governing legal standard to guide the court's review. And in particular, in the case law points out that the regulation providing the authority to engage in sua sponte reopening uses the term may, and thus there's not a discretionary sua sponte reopening is only discretionary. However, 8 CFR section 1003.1D12 imposes a duty on the board to exercise independent judgment and discretion in cases coming before it. There is a governing legal standard here. The board has that duty. The regulation says shall. So,
but we've already said that we don't have jurisdiction in these cases on sua sponte reopening. Are you arguing contrary to our precedent?
I can't recall the case off the top of my head, but it's cited in the brief, both in the reply brief and in the opening brief in this section, that the underlying issue is that where the decision allowed, that where there is a governing legal standard, the court can have jurisdiction.
But we've already analyzed this and said, because it's sua sponte and it's completely discretionary, we don't have jurisdiction over these. It wasn't just in a one-off thing. It's a announcement that we're not going to take sua sponte reopening and parse it going forward in our circuit.
Well, I just have to point to the case I'm referring to, cited in the brief, that allows that if there is a governing legal standard. So, for instance, that particular case discussed the possibility that there could be a constitutional challenge, ultimately decided that a constitutional challenge wasn't cognizable, but nevertheless, because there was a governing legal standard, the court had a meaningful way to, a governing legal standard to meaningfully guide its review, and thus it could. At the end of the day, the reason why the court has determined that it doesn't have jurisdiction over these challenges is because there's nothing to guide the court's discretion or to guide the court's review. Where there is, the court should review it. I'll reserve the rest of my time.
Thank you. You've saved time for rebuttal. Mr. Ramnitz?
Thank you, General. The agency not arbitrarily denied petitioner's motion to reopen an in-absentia removal order premised on lack of notice or improper service of an order to show cause, OSC for short. First, the board reasonably found that petitioner received proper notice of his June 1994 hearing. Petitioner does not dispute that service on counsel of record and notice of hearing constitutes proper service. He does not dispute that attorney Iris Jarabe was served with notice of this hearing. And he also does not dispute, this is from his 2019 affidavit, that he engaged Irish Arave to represent him before the immigration judge in the deportation proceedings in 1994, authorizing her to be her agent. What he argues is that some 20 years later, because there's no longer a notice of appearance in the record, that ipso facto, she was not his authorized agent. But as he admits in his opening brief, there's no case law saying this. He has a regulation that states that an attorney shall file a notice of appearance, which is true, but we don't know, one, that Yaya Sarabi never filed a notice of appearance. The record states she certified in the motion to change venue that she did file a notice of appearance, and the AG over and over recognized her as attorney of record and accepted filing from her. And second, nothing says that if someone doesn't file a notice of appearance, that they're not an authorized agent. It's done in different ways. There's no case law stating that. All the case law that petitioner cites is when the immigration judge refuses to recognize someone as attorney of record because they've not filed a notice of appearance or otherwise perfected their appearance before the agency. These cases simply aren't relevant. We don't know there was a lack of notice of appearance. By the record state, there was. She certified
Mr. Ramnitz,
there was no appearance.
What is the latest time that there is something from Tamayac to indicate that this person is his lawyer? What's the last thing where that recognition appears in some document, either from the lawyer or from signed by Tamayac or not?
Well, the last time is the motion to withdraw, and that was in 1995.
Well, that may be a stretch with all due respect, if that's an indication that, certainly an indication the lawyer still thought that she had some role to play. What I'm thinking of, help me with the dates here, there do seem to be documents in 1993, at least one signed by Tamayac himself, that this was his lawyer. Request to change a venue from Miami to Houston was filed in 93, I believe. There's some affidavit filed in June of 94. I don't know how, if Tamayac himself was on any of those documents. I was trying to get the record open right now on my computer, couldn't make it work. One of my concerns here, I'm not saying it's outcome determinative, is that what we hear in 95 is the lawyer can't find the client. And it's at least been a year from anything that's been filed that there was a relationship between the two. How much of that's Tamayac's fault and otherwise, or factors perhaps. So I'm just asking you as a factual matter, when do we last know that there was communication between the two and this particular lawyer and Tamayac were literally on the same page or same document with their signatures or in some other way? And was it 94, was it 93?
According to the record, it was June 2nd, 1994, the motion to change venue, where it's an affidavit bearing his signature. He submitted on his
signature. Affidavit, as I understand it, was filed in June of 94, well, at least it was filed in 94, yeah, filed in June 94, and Tamayac signed that?
Yes.
Okay. Keep going. I clear up the factual part for me. I mean, there's that one-year gap thereafter.
Well, that was venue changing from Miami to Houston for his request, because he explained that he was moving to Houston, and that's why he engaged attorney Urabe, who was actually a Houston-based attorney, to get the venue out of Miami to Houston, where he lived, where attorney Urabe lived. That might explain that delay of 1 year, but nothing of consequence happened during that time. What happened is that petitioner's counsel, or attorney Urabe, lost contact with the petitioner. We've seen her motion to withdraw. She said, as the panel noted, she went to his address trying to find him per her duty as counsel of record, or what agency recognized her as counsel of record. Regulation case law required counsel of record to show what efforts they took to locate their client before doing ex parte motion to withdraw. At every step in this record, it shows that this was his authorized agent who received process on his behalf. And petitioner is looking, these 20 years later, trying to unwind his proceedings, looking for technicality. But even if, well, there's not a notice to appear in the record that supports his, doesn't mean it wasn't his authorized agent. And this was more thoroughly explained by Ninth Circuit in Martinez-Zelaya, that the government cited, where petitioner made the same argument. they were trying to unwind the concession of deportability by their attorney, and they said, well, look, we no longer can see a notice of appearance in the records, but it's de facto that wasn't my attorney, and so I can withdraw that concession. And the court said, that's not how that works. The regulation means they shall file a notice of appearance. It doesn't mean they weren't your authorized agent. Regulations contemplate other ways you can authorize someone to be your attorney before the immigration courts.
It might not be either here nor there. Was there any effort by you or anything in the record that indicates in proceedings which go to completion or at least undertake them some period of time, do not have these forms filed? I know nothing about the sort of culture of it all. These forms filed half the time, 10% of the time, all the time. This is the one time in 25 years there wasn't one.
I don't know, Your Honor. I've never seen an argument like this.
Would that be relevant? Would it be relevant? Would that undermine any statutory obligation that these are not regularly filed or widely filed?
I think they are widely filed. In my own experience, I do see notices of appearances in the record. I don't commonly see an attorney representing someone before the agency without a G-28 in the record.
When is it filed? We have things
usually,
93, 94, then in 95. Should have been filed at the very beginning of all of this? 93?
Well, at least before the motion change venue, because that is where Iris Rabe certifies at the end of the document that she has already filed a notice of appearance. So she stated that, and as petitioner states in his affidavit, he stated that Rabe said that to him. I've done everything I need to do to perfect my appearance before the immigration court. So what we have is just, it's a missing notice of appearance. Unlike all the cases petitioner cites where it's a failure to file a notice of appearance, we just have something 20 years later where it's just not there anymore. Every other piece of evidence says this was his authorized agent before the immigration court. And moving on to the order to show cause argument, as the board properly found, petitioner conceded he was an actual receipt of the order to show cause in his own words, in his own affidavit signed in his own hand. It was not signed by attorney Rabe stating that she received the order.
So is that some sort of argument that he is stopped to argue some of these by some kind of, you know, judicial estoppel, that you can't argue something and, you know, that he's personally done this and it's not arguing that it's forged or something.
Right, he's not arguing it's forged, and the government pointed out in a brief, the signature appears identical to his signature from 2019. He never made that argument, and you can phrase it as waiver, as the panel did in petitioner's argument. You can phrase it as estoppel, but at the end of the day, actual receipt of a document is all you need, because I know petitioner is banging on the case matter of Huete, where there's a lack of a certified mailing receipt in the record, but that case says that the whole purpose of a certified mailing receipt is to show actual receipt, to show the person got it in their hand, and that's what petitioner says. He says, I did receive the order to show cause. He got it in his hand. So there's just nothing more to argue with the order to show cause. That's why he's attempting to invalidate it through this notice of appearance argument.
Do you have anything further?
I do not, Your Honor.
Mr. Boom, you've saved time for rebuttal.
Thank you. So just a few things. So I want to point out that the government relies on Martinez Zayala, the Ninth Circuit case. I addressed this in the reply brief. The Ninth Circuit has read that case to be limited to situations where, as in the facts there, but unlike here, the attorney makes a personal appearance. That also did not involve questions of notice, and in the rationale for why the notice of appearance wasn't a crucial factor, the court pointed out, well, the notice of appearance just serves a notification function, but that notification function is might not be important where an attorney personally appears and makes concessions with the respondent sitting there, but when it's a question of who should receive notice, that notification function is crucial. Government also stated that he's never come across a case like this, but various unpublished decisions of the board cited both in the opening brief and in the reply brief show that the board routinely rescinds in absentia orders for lack of proper notice in cases for the sole reason that there is no notice of appearance in the record. And finally,
even in those cases, I mean, I'll go back and look, but even in cases where the court was acting and ruling on the motion submitted by the lawyer,
that I'm not sure.
Yeah, because that's my, to me, that's what you are then appearing. You are the agent if the court is granting your motions. But anyway, that, I'll take a look at the cases. Yeah.
Well, I would just say, I mean, even in those instances, that one would say that the court is acting improperly recognizing the attorney as
well. That goes to my, I just don't think we would say a 1995 opinion from our court is wiped off the books 25 years later because someone can go back and find out that there's no appearance form in the docket. I mean, that just seems, that doesn't make sense to me.
And I agree, in that situation, it doesn't make sense, but the statute does provide that lack of proper notice renders one eligible to rescission at any time. Maybe it's relevant for a discretionary analysis, but not the threshold question of eligibility. As far as the government also relies on the order to show cause and for service of the order to show cause on the fact that the signatures match up, I just point out that the broader principle at line here is what distinguishes the requirements for an order to show cause versus a notice. A hearing notice, as discussed in the briefs, is that for an order to show cause, a condition of effective service is proof of actual receipt. And there was no way for the judge to have known that to have the actual this other signature that my client submitted with the motion to reopen when my client was ordered removed. All the judge had to go by was the representation by the attorney that this was my client's signature. There was no independent proof that they were one and the same.
Your client signed the affidavit and in the affidavit filed with the motion for reopening, as pointed out by the board, the respondent did not deny signing the affidavit and does not deny receiving the OSC. So he had a chance to say, no, this isn't me. I didn't really sign these documents. He personally signed the documents that say that he had the notice. This is not the lawyer making his representation on his behalf. Why aren't you a stop to make this argument when your client has personally admitted that he had notice? And so why aren't you a stop to make this argument?
Because proof of actual receipt was a condition of effective service, which itself was a precondition for personal jurisdiction at best. And that proof of actual service didn't occur until the filing of the motion to reopen. It did not occur before my client was ordered removed, and thus the immigration judge did not have personal jurisdiction at that time.
Okay, we have your argument. Thank you, counsel, for your arguments today. This case is submitted. Let's turn to the next case for the day, please.